I put together the slide to talk a little bit about the web and how far we've come as far as the web is concerned. So, about 25 years ago, the web wasn't was nothing like what we have now. There was this guy named Tim Benedi, and he was working from a research lab in Geneva. And he was a contractor then, and the core focus of his job was to help the physicists in any ways, as far as computers go. So one core thing he focused on was how best could he make it possible for these researchers to send documents to other researchers and be able to have it in a better formatted way. So he started out looking at newspapers and how best he could adapt what was present in newspapers to be able to make the presentation of the documents better. So he picked up something that looked like HTML, then known as the standard generalized markup language, which he added more tags to by looking at the newspaper. So it's quite interesting how like the web didn't start actually by thinking of connecting machines together, but actually how to present documents, which is like HTML, which is what he came up with. So one interesting thing he added, he dropped as far as improving document presentation goals, was dropping in links. So now he could link documents to others within the same machine. The next focus he had was how could he make researchers be able to share these documents among themselves, and that's where the web came out. Now he built the first web browser, which was meant to be able to pass the specification that he came up with, and he shared it. So he was working from Europe, so he shared it over the web, and those who had access to it. So the web wasn't grown then, but people who had access to it downloaded the browser. Some way, somehow, to my research, I didn't know how they got to their first browser, but they got it. And some guys in the US, Mark Andreessen and Eric Benner, they built out the first advanced version of the browser he sent out, and they made a lot of money out of that. Well, fast forward into 2000s. Now we see two groups of people on the web: those who are actually building and improving the web, and those who are actually moving their businesses onto the web. So we had things like web publishing, which was obvious, because then we had HTML and then CSS, which made presentation, web presentation much better. And then people started moving businesses like brick and mortar shops onto the web, advertisements, and then social network platforms. Now, fast forward 2005, and now that we need more to actually be able to move the web forward. So we started having advanced tools like Ruby on Rails. I couldn't find a better logo to represent it. And Git, which that'll kill me. and Git, and more and more businesses. And interestingly, 2005 moving on, the kind of businesses we saw on the web weren't ones that were brick and mortar that were actually moved on. These companies were created on the web. Something like YouTube and Twitter came out during that time. Now, we face a challenge currently. And the challenge is more and more tools come up. And when we take these two groups of people, we have those who are still building for the web and those who are actually still building businesses on top of the web. Well, for those who are actually helping to improve the web, we face a lot of challenges. You just don't start by like starting out. There's something, you need to know that something. So there's a lot for you to know. For instance, for a beginner, if you are joining the web, first thing you need to know is the basics: HTML, CSS, JavaScript. Next, someone tells you, okay, if you want your application to be data-driven, you need to know a backend language. So you might roll up with PHP, Rails, or Node. Well, you need a place to store this data. The next thing is to consider which database to use. You might go with MySQL, that's if you go with PHP. And Rails, they'll force you to use Postgres, like here. And then Node, they'll say, like, it's obvious, dude. Objects are all over JavaScript, so you should just use my MongoDB and just jump it in there, right? And you don't have to think about relationships. Next, they say, Charlie, you are not even a developer if you don't know how to use the command line, so you need to be a power user of the command line. Now they are like, you create a project and then you store it as like, okay, project one. The next time you want to create a copy, they're like, project one final, and you're like, yeah, I need to change this project final, completely final. And they're like, dude, you need to use a version control tool, so you go with Git. Now you join a company and they're like, yeah. So the way we work over here is we need to keep the environment the same. So you should use a tool like Vagrant. You don't even know what Vagrant is. You don't even care about its conversion. So you just go with it. Now you keep working with this tool and then you go home. You work on your personal projects. You Google up, yeah, I need to use this slogan thing, but it's too huge. Now you're thinking about size. You're like, okay, let me go with Docker. It's actually cool, but it can't convince your business to use it, so you just go with Docker. The next thing is now this, all your projects are lacking on GitHub, so now you want to push some of them to the cloud. So you start thinking about deployment, and if you don't take time, you might die. Like, you go through, if you ask someone, challenge, where can I hold this? My friend uses cPanel, like, dude, you are using Rails, you need something much more, so go with AWS or DigitalOcean. And then if you don't die, like, no, no, no. So now you move a bit higher. You go beyond the basics and you start meeting like gurus, and they start telling you, you don't know anything about MVC, you need to revise, you need to go in more. They're like, see, he's using methods to format his string, you should know regex by now. And then you're like, you use ORMs, you should know raw queries, at least you should be able to write raw SQL queries. And if you enter into the world of testing, you might die. They start doing testing, TDD, BDD, DDD, API testing, accessibility testing, you might just die. And for design patterns, the first guy was hitting the gang of four. They're like, you should go through all this and be able to apply it. That could kill you, I swear. And then they talk about architecture. You don't even know the kind of architecture they are talking about. So you start out with articles, looking at what architecture means. You start implementing stuff you don't even understand, but you just have to do it. And then API design, because now you're like, separate your front end from your back end. So you're like, okay, let me build APIs. But now you need to understand how to actually build out your API. And if you enter the world of JavaScript framework, because that's what you need for your front end, you might just die. if you don't end up succeeding here, you might end up like this. Seriously. Now, one thing I found interesting, especially in my career path, is we could learn so much from other industries. And one of the industries I find interesting is plumbing. So you see, a plumber comes over to fix or put together your sink, and all he has to do is put about three things together and it's working. And when he charges you, you start crying. Now, this is a quote by Bram Cox, the creator of Objective C language. He says, software engineering is not yet plumbing or Legos because our standards are incomplete. Our library is incomplete, scaling is still not free, and our software is still buggy. Well, he said this a long time ago, and we began to see improvements. For instance, pick a platform like GitHub, very credible platform. It has enabled us to be able to collaborate. It has improved open source hugely. We've been able to collaborate on projects and make them better. There's so much happening right now. But we kind of feel like, I kind of feel like we can do more in terms, as far as open source goes and as far as improving the web goes. Why can't we keep these projects alive? Like, instead of keeping them in repositories, why not put these projects up and alive? Why can't I pick a GD library in PHP that makes formatting images or working with images much more easier and use it in my Rails app? Why can't I pick the Eloquent ORM library and use it in my app and be able to go? Why do I have to commit myself to one particular tribe or something? Well, that's why we started work on DevNet. The sole aim of our project is to be able to make this possible. Be able to use, like, it shouldn't matter what the library is written, you should be able to have it in your application. And I shouldn't run an open source project and it should be in my repo and I always have to think about how easy is it for someone to install it or whatever. I should just keep it alive and make it possible for people to use it. And the reason I feel that is important is, consider the kind of technologies coming up right now. Right now, you can spin up an instance and have it scale automatically. So why can't I put that library out there and enable people to be able to use it out there? So, well, I'm about to show you, like, let me show you how this works on DevNet. So this is like the sample DevNet dashboard. So what we term libraries or packages or whatever you want to extend to the external world is services. So, to connect services, you can do it in two ways. One is by hosting the package itself somewhere else and then pulling it into DevNet. And once it gets there, there's this interesting technology we've been working with so far. It's JSON RPC. It's kind of like REST, but this time you get to call methods directly. So if I have about three methods, let's say method one, method two, method three in Ruby, I could be able to call it directly, either in JavaScript within my front end or within PHP, but I just call it like methods, which I find interesting. Or for the PHP guys, okay, I'll show you then. So let me show you how to go through creating a service. And okay, before I jump into this, so one thing we realized was to make this possible, we actually needed to achieve four things. We needed to make and keep storing data much more easier, be able to write some kind of rules, and then be able to have a user interface to manage it. And how did we come about this? For instance, if I pick a library like the Python NLTK library, which is very good for natural learning, natural language processing, I want to be able to distribute this in a way that, for instance, I could pick that library and use it to analyze corpus just to get some sample out of data. Or I could distribute it in a way where like someone could just pick it and be able to get some sentiments out of the application, which is something much more concrete. So we came up with the idea of console. And what a console allows me to do is, once I pull in my library, I can have a user interface for it. So for instance, I have this image uploader right here, and we have a simple console that allows me to be able to interact with the library directly before I even start calling out my text. But by the time we had added all of these, we have put together all of these core things we felt we needed to make this complete, we realized that even to begin building your application, you could just start off with DevCongress. You don't necessarily need to start pulling out libraries, and that's what I want to show you. So here I'll create a simple service like Word. And here I could connect to the default database on which DevCongress is installed, or connect to a remote database somewhere if my service requires me. So I'll go ahead and create this. And now head over to tables. Here I can create a table. Say, since it's Word, we should create places. And then places have names. I'll leave it as that. Go ahead and create a table. Next, people live in places. So let me add people. People have names. And people live in places. So cool thing is, when I'm creating fields, for instance, this name field, I've labeled it as text. If I require more, I could make it text area. If it's an integer, I could make it so. And DevCongress handles the validation automatically. So instead of going like int big, that you just select the field and it drops in the validation for you. So people live in places. So I'm going to choose this as reference and make these places. Make these places and then create my table. Right, and as a developer, I could head over to the API console and play around with my table. So I'm going to select the world service, okay, places first. Let's add a couple of places. So I go like Ghana, and then let's add one more. Say the US, and then I add this up. All right, so let's add a couple of people. Record. All right, so Edmond, I live in Ghana, and then Yao. No. Who doesn't want to go to the US? Lives in US. All right, so now I've been able to add a couple of records. I could go ahead and then query, say, let's query people. Table, and here I see the record of people. And because DevCongress handles relationship automatically, I could say, okay, pull in everything that is related to people. And here now I see Edmond is related to places, and then I get the whole data about places. One interesting thing we just began working on is so we started out by adding scripts, and what scripts allows, alright, so we began working on scripts. At first, scripts was all about writing logic, but we realized that instead of forcing people to write out logic in the language in which DevCongress implemented, which is PHP, why not allow them to write something that is much more neutral? And it shouldn't be logic, it should be validation. And the reason why we went with writing scripts as validation is the fact that, well, if for instance, I require my user from the front end to push in their name as being capitalized, well, I could validate from here instead of actually changing it into capitals from here. That means all we need is some form of assertion from this point. So over here, you see, I have I'm like, okay, whenever data comes in, I said that post is equal to post. Oh shit! So I was messing around with this one. So it's like else fails that way, or else whenever this, whenever that. Fail. So it's kind of like it's still implemented in PHP though, but the next step for us is to write a parser that allows you to write something much more neutral. And good. And that whole the whole thing I said about Jason RPC and you being able to call methods, being able to call methods from another one language in another. Let me show you how that works. So when we created our world service, it created a view folder for us. Let me expand this. So it created a world folder for us, and we should, for PHP, instead of having your code somewhere, your package somewhere, you could write your package directly within DevLess, and you'll be able to access it from your front end. So for instance, I have a method here, method one. I could try querying it from the front end. So I'll go ahead and then hit my front end page. Yeah. And I'm going to change this to world. And I'll try and call on that. And it says here, my resource is private. And that's because I added an annotation on top of the method one, which is private. That means no one else outside can call on it. So I'll just change this to public, and then change the return statement, say DevCongress. Save this and then try again. Okay, so it got a RPC response, and I can check from here my payload, and I see DevCongress out there. So I'm calling it in JavaScript, but it's from PHP. So basically, that's the project we are working on. And for some time now, we've been under the shadows. We've not really come out. It's because we had to figure some stuff out before we actually ask for help or actually get people on board to use it. So we've been working on our deployment options. We've been working on specifications and actually drawing some kind of plan that goes a long way so we can start calling on people. And currently, we've gotten to the stage where we need people to help us out with the SDK part of it. And some things we are still thinking about is like, okay, we put up an email service, and then whoever helps us, whoever contributes some of the SDK, will be able to share this email package out there for free. Well, that marks the end of my talk. My name is Edmond, and you can reach me via email or Twitter. And that's my co-founder, Chachu. Thank you very much.